Шановні пані і панове, сьогодні ми покажемо вам два короткі фільми. Це англомовні фільми, вони дуже цікаві. The second complements the first very nicely. Перший фільм називається Константин Бокан, one of millions of victims of the Holodomor. А другий називається Wendy Star. Я хотів би представити наших двох доповідачів. Перше, я представлю Степана Остафійчука, який відповідає за перший фільм, а тоді доктора Бориса Буняка, який відповідає за другий фільм. Стефан Остафійчук є провідний член Ліги українців Канади, він є член тієї управи, а також він є голова дирекції Ukrainian Cultural Center Dnipro Trust. Він дуже творчий. Стефан фактично ангажує себе в кожен проект по Голодомору, за котрий Ліга українців Канади. І Ліга українців Канади це разом організує з дослідним інститутом України. Він, Стефан, це робить систематично від планування до імплементації. Зокрема, проект наш найбільш успішний екзибит in a box. Ви може знаєте, що ж про цей проект, 101 плакат. Документальні фільми про Голодомор. Такий пакет, який ми вже продаємо з 2008 року до сьогодні. Стефан тісно співпрацював з родиною Пуцаків. Вони фактично це разом творили. Цей фільм. Ліга є продюсером цього першого фільму, а Стефан є режисером. Я попросив би Стефана сказати кілька слів про цей фільм, і тоді ми його покажемо. Стефан, будь ласка.
It's easier for me to speak in English because I'm still very embarrassed about my quality of Ukrainian after 61 years. This whole project with the story of Constantin Bokan is actually a poster exhibit in the major project of the Holodomor that Liga had put together. I am a museum and art gallery junkie who goes to many, many exhibits just out of passion for audiovisual. Having understood the story, the content, and how heavy and how detailed the information has been collected, and how much problems and stress and propaganda against the Holodomor that have been put up by naysayers over the generations, over the decades. When I saw this one picture of this one family, for me, that personified everything about the Holodomor. Well, let me take a step back. When I was a kid, we had this lady who was our housekeeper. My dad was a doctor, mom worked in the office. Pani Karpenko would always get very upset if you never finished your food. And to the point of crying and very hysterical. So we always ate everything on our plate. Вона дуже часто сказала, що скінчи їсти, бо то може бути останній раз. It wasn't until after she had passed away that I found out that she lost her first two children and her husband to the Holodomor. But she never spoke about it. She also had the tattoos on her arms from the concentration camps. She never, ever showed her arms. And again, the whole story was something that for me when I got involved with this was to honor the memory of people who weren't sharing the memories with us. So this project was basically 5 minutes to come up with a concept. It took me a couple weeks to find a 13-year-old kid who could do YouTube to put it together for me. And then by the grace of God, I met Pani Pucak from Tribe Printing. And her son, who's a teenager, became the voice and the personification of Constantin. The value of this presentation for me was for children, because even though I've never had kids, my sisters and my sister's a principal, and I understood that if we could each, if nothing else, teach the word Holodomor to children, they would understand at least something about their heritage and history. This, the story is basically all the key tenets of what happened during the Holodomor. I'd like for you to see the film, and I think it is basically self-explanatory. Jack Redushin.
Хочу тепер представити нашого гостя з Америки, доктор Борис Буняк, приїхав з дружиною з Syracuse, New York, щоб бути з нами. Сьогодні доктор Буняк є продюсером фільму «When We Start». По-перше, хочу підкреслити, що пан Борис є член US Holodomor Committee, президент Central New York Chapter of Humana, президент Humana з 2015 до 2017 року. He was chairman of endoscopy and associate professor of medicine at St. Joseph's Medical Center in Syracuse. Прошу сердечно привітати доктора.
Дякую, що ви мене запросили. І я вже показую цей фільм так потрошку вже майже рік, але два дні тому, що сталося, що той директор чи продюсер, що я з ним працював на цьому фільмі, він це видав на інтернет. Because день 22 листопада. І за 48 годин вже 3700 людей дивилося вже цей фільм тільки за ці два дні. То я думаю, що нам пощастило. З вашою допомогою, ми тут було минулого року, ми перше показували цей фільм, і я вам дуже дякую за ваші поради, як цей фільм зробити. Це почалося два роки тому, як я ще був президентом Humana для Канади і для Америки. І US Holodomor Committee мене запитали, як ще я можу щось там робити, щоб показувати людям, що сталося в людині, як вона So we embarked on this program and we started amassing medical information on what happens to an individual when they start. What happens to them physiologically, what happens to them psychologically, and even spiritually. Unfortunately, with my contacts in Ukraine, with Dr.Ewald Ammende, Boris Kudziak, and Mohlet, та два інтерв'ю, щоб вам показувати, що діється в людині, що їм стається, як вона голодує. І ми перше це показували, ми показували і PowerPoint presentation. І ми це показували, перше пішли до Syracuse University, and we showed some professors what we were trying to do. And he goes, you know, if you want an impactful amount of information, a film or documentary would be much more effective in getting to the population. So that's what we did. Now, the problem was I never made a film in my life. This was my first attempt at making a film. And the rude awakening was my budget from the US Holodomor Committee was $3,000. Now, I'm not a filmmaker, so I didn't know what that meant. And I go, $3,000, okay, I can do something like that. And then when I started asking around, you know, it was close to $80,000 to $100,000 to make a 15-minute movie. And that's when I was like, how am I gonna do that? So I figured, I'm gonna do it myself. And that's what we did. То я жінкою не роз'їжджалася, всюди, щоб з ними говорити. And the goal, it actually came out very well because we've spoken to many teachers and professors. We've showed the movie multiple times. I've showed it to directors, I've showed it to other people, historians and librarians, and they gave us a lot of constructive criticism about the film. So here's my first attempt at a film. Hope it's okay, and I'll take some questions afterwards. And the object of this film is actually to present this to high school students and universities. It's supposed to be only a 10 to 15 minute film so that they could be shown in the beginning of a classroom, either on genocide or Holodomor. And they, once they show the film, they can have discussions. It's in piecemeal, and you'll see it's in piecemeal. So I'm trying to get a lot of information in 15 minutes, but there's so many things you can expand upon in a classroom, and we've been showing that. And some of the teachers have already produced that. We're using it in Michigan already. We've presented it at Syracuse University. We have good reviews. And we're going to Miami-Dade College next week to show the same. So I'll show you the film, and then we'll have a discussion afterwards. Any questions? Yes.
Я побував в англійській, мені трошки легше, то що я чула. Дуже вам дякую. Дякую, що ви будете такі, як ви, що ви це показуєте, показуєте тут життям, щоб вони це знали. Ми знаємо, але щоб світ знав і мав ворні, what's going on. Я виділа програму на PBS того року і говорила, що people who were starved during the Second World War, we talked about the Second World War, that was an effect on the genetics, not only of the people who were starved, but of their grandchildren.
Yeah, there's a, what ends up happening, there's methylation of certain parts of the DNA, which actually reduces the metabolism of the individual, which is basically a way to survive not having food. So the metabolism drops, even the ability to think drops, and actually the individuals who, there's a cohort of individuals, there's a Dutch famine and a Chinese famine from the 40s and the 50s, which they followed the birth mothers and the children afterwards to see exactly what the effects were. And they found that individuals that were starved in the womb or in the first, second, third trimester, there's a higher increased frequency of affective disorder, schizophrenia, and also addictive disorders. But there's also an interesting part of that is we're looking at our rate of obesity. Our metabolism, for those people who have been starved, their metabolism has decreased, and now the effect of our individuals, when we see food, we want to eat it. And not only that, now we're gaining weight, and our metabolism is not as good as it used to be, because that was a genetic defect from when the people were starved in World War II and other famines. So yes, there is a definite change in the DNA of individuals who have been starved.
But how would that affect the grandchildren? They also mentioned that these mothers couldn't conceive and that it affected the grandchildren also.
Well, the DNA changes in the starving mother and in the womb. So that DNA is now being transferred to their siblings. So we're only three generations out. We don't know what's going to happen in the fourth or fifth generation yet. So that's still tough to see. Now, what we are doing is, my wife, who's a psychologist, we're actually talking about trying to talk to the children of the Holodomor survivors and then see exactly how it affected them in some way. My family was not part of the Holodomor, but we had survivor guilt. You know, why did we survive? So that's something else that we're actually looking into. There's a lot of things that we can get from all this information. We just have to move on. But since once genetics change, that adaptability continues on.
If I could just step in for a second, I found some real poignant commonalities in the two projects that were shown here today. The video that we did for Ukrainica was geared towards children of grades 5 to grade 8. The whole concept of using the voice of a child is because the Usme Estonia people hearing what Dido and Baba had gone through is one thing for a child to hear it from an adult or from an elder, but to actually hear the context of a voice or something they could relate to was a really compelling moment watching children actually watch the video. The whole purpose for what we were trying to do, the pictures that we were used were actually pictures that are taken out of, which were historically accurate, verified through the book. The actual storyline was basically a narration of the key points of what a person would have gone through. The physiology of starvation was something that I very much related to with your film. I wish I would have had that information before I started mine. But the bottom line for us was it's a continuing education, and by having two videos that address younger children and then high school and universities is a very compelling and I think fortuitous for us all that have you here with the film. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I mean, it's great because we can show your film to the younger, to elementary school. And our film has already been shown to ninth grade and up into the universities. And one of the things that we also wanted to do is actually show this to our Ukrainian school studies on Saturdays. Because what we also found is our students, our Ukrainian students, who learn about the Holodomor, sometimes they're not that assertive in schools to say that it is there or not. Like our daughter, she decided to do a term paper on the Holodomor, and her professor looked at her and said, is that really such a thing? And she goes, well, yeah, there's such a thing. Well, show me the evidence. There's no evidence. And then she said, well, it was a genocide against Ukrainian people. And she also said, well, if that wasn't a genocide, that's proved it's a genocide. So she went ahead and she did write it. So people with that bravery need to go out to universities and teach our professors and our teachers that it did exist and show the evidence. She brought the Appleton book to him and said, okay, well, if this is a myth, how come all these people like Robert Conquest or James Mace, there's Anne Applebaum, you know, all these people have been studying this, and so if that's a myth, then you need to discredit all those authors prior to that. So we need to make sure our children promote this in the schools, and hopefully that word will get out.
I have a question for you regarding your young narrator. I was very impressed by him. Did he give you any reflections on what it was like, reading your script?
The young narrator was 15 at the time. His name is Theodore Putsak. His father and mother are publishers. They own Trident Press, and they do a lot of work for the Ukrainian Vermont. He was a budding thespian who has managed to establish a pretty good career in the film industry here in Toronto. He and I actually sat down and I just kind of laid out the story. He didn't say a word for 3 days, and then he came back and said, I want to do this. The tone and the inflection, the scripting of the story, it took less than 5 minutes. And then it took me to find a teenager who could do the YouTube, glue it together, and then I found the Putsaks, who had the professional whereabouts of machinery and tools and software to put it all together. Even the music was done by Mrs. Putsak. And so the whole thing was to evoke the whole sense of emotion, the physical pain as he's talking, going through the stages of the physiology of starvation. The timeline, to put it to July 1st, I pulled that as an arbitrary date, only to give you the sense of how long it takes to starve to death. The way he was talking, matter of fact, we weren't communist bashing. We had discussions about how much we wanted to keep it to the story. We tied in afterwards the fact that the father and the brother ended up dying in the gulag, just added a nice tie-in for the rest of the story. So the family tragedy wasn't just through 1932-33, went right up to the 39-40s. And so it's an ongoing kind of a process. We put in there where he's going through the Our Father. Again, there's an example of not being able to have a complete thought process. There's a certain benefit to having Wikipedia at your fingertips. I didn't have the benefit of a doctor, but we tried to get the point across. And he showed it to quite a number of schools where the kids are very young and rambunctious, disorderly. Within a minute or two of getting into the film, they're very serious, they're mesmerized by it. I've actually had really intelligent questions from 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds, which was really not edited, but really, really pulling on the heartstrings that they got it. And even if they don't know the politics or the total body count or the whole story of Stalin and what we've gone through, they get the understanding of what Holodomor was. And for me, just getting the word out there, Holodomor was from an awareness point of view. Now, being able to take it into the higher grades and into the colleges and universities,
think this is a nice wraparound for the two of us.
I mean, interesting.
Excuse me, gentlemen.
Would
you be able to speak either louder or into the mic?
Sorry.
You can probably hear or
okay.
Understand.
Okay, sorry.
Well, there is trying to find Holodomor survivors and willing to talk about the Holodomor was also a little bit difficult. We found two. Fortunately, one of them was my godmother, who never told us, so that worked out great. But the two individuals I wish to speak with, they were gung-ho, but as soon as we brought in cameras, one developed a heart attack and refused to talk about it ever again, and the family told us never to come back again because, you know, Gita's going to pass away the second time we tried to talk about it. The second one, it was being built up for a week, I was going to come to his house, and he became so nervous that his name would go out there, that, you know, his family in Ukraine is also going to be attacked. He ended up heart failure, also had a heart attack. So, because these are all people in their 90s. So it was sort of stepping back and realizing that there's still a fear. In our family, we have members who have gone through the Holodomor and they don't want their names out there because they still have that fear that still some of them come after them. Even now, you know, even in 2019, they still have that fear.
In my personal situation, getting involved with the Holodomor is basically I got involved with the Holodomor out of survivor's guilt because she wasn't my baba, she was our housekeeper, and she never spoke about it. And it was only after the fact that she had passed away that I actually found out about her story. So for me, this is an attempt to give back to something that we weren't doing as a fallen generation.
Okay, I heard something that in a sociological process of starvation that in their early stages they're protesting about it, and then when they start starving it quiets down, and maybe like, you know, Venezuela, remember all the protests, and then like what happened to them? Is it a similar pattern there?
Well,
yeah.
medically and psychologically, for the first 6 hours when you're starving or you're not having food, you get that term that's now in the Webster's Dictionary, hangry. So people get angry because they don't have food, they get a little irritable. So the very people are irritable in the beginning, and they're looking for food. But then after about 3 or 4 days without food, you become a little bit more subdued, and you just sort of lose that energy because there's no more energy to fight. They do have bouts of euphoria. There are some people who just become like almost like a bipolar. So they're very, very happy for a day or so, then they're very, very sad the next day. So it's like the body short-circuiting, I would say, you know, as you're starting to not having enough energy. But eventually, just like Liana Sopruno mentioned, you're just going to lose all your energy. You're just going to want to sleep all day. And interestingly, the body still has an ability that once it senses food, you actually do wake up, and you can't wait to get to that food. But when you've starved significantly, any amount of food that you take in too quickly, you have to understand that after a certain amount of time, the gastrointestinal tract has atrophied. It can't absorb food like it used to. So as soon as you start eating something, you get diarrhea, you get dehydration, and you die from dysentery. Not because it's an infection, but because you can't absorb the amount of material in your body needs to produce 9 liters of fluid to digest food. And if you don't have that 9 liters, you're
going to
succumb to dehydration.
One interesting thing that I had learned when we were working on the exhibit, I became very much a Holodomor junkie, pardon the term, to learn as much as I possibly could. But one of the big striking things that hit me early on was when the Soviets and the communists were going to confiscate grains and cattle and everything else, they always went in with a military force, a superior force. So you had numerous uprisings over the years, but when it actually come to pillaging and taking foodstuffs away, you can't really fight an armed force or a guy who comes at you with a gun or a bayonet or comes at you with a club. So even if you were trying to put up resistance in the early days, you're always overwhelmed by the masses of the forces that were against you.
Я хочу, щоб подякувати вам за ці фільми і
як педагог, як вчитель, як директор суботньої школи, що ми говорили про потребу виховання дітей. Дуже коротко свого досвіду скажу, що дуже добре працює, коли у школі дітям показувати ось такі фільми. Константина Буханя я практикую показувати вже, напевно, останні 5 років, може більше. І скажу, що цей фільм можна показувати дітям, починаючи від 10-річного віку. Там є кілька шокуючих кадрів, але вони не є аж такі шокуючі, щоб не показувати дітям. Навпаки, це спрацьовує як поштовх до пізнання своєї історії і до того, що дитина замислюється, хто я є, якого я роду, чому мене це стосується. Я дуже сподіваюся, що наступної суботи зможу показати фільм доктора Будняка своїм дітям. І стосовно того, що ви розказували про випадок зі своєю донею, що вона приходить і професор їй говорить, відмовляється вірити, що таке було, просто заперечує Голодомор, то перед ось такими подіями, перед фільмами, перед вивченням Голодомору дуже часто говорю дітям: діти, ви зараз пізнаєте свою історію і несете в світ те, що, можливо, інші не знають або не хочуть знати, закривають вуха і очі, відмовляються вірити в те, що таке було. Але кожен з вас, ви навіть цього не знаєте, кожен з вас вже є представником того народу, в генах якого закладено оце все, про що ми сьогодні говоримо. І настане момент для кожного з вас, рано чи пізно, цей момент своєї істини, коли ви тут і зараз відповідаєте за Шевченкової формули, за мертвих і живих і ненароджених земляків своїх в Україні і не в Україні суще. Коли вас хтось запитає, от із Голодомор, чому всі про це говорять? Socialist без not so bad, as an idea, так? З чим, наприклад, моя дочка спитувалася, коли викладач Ваську сказав, що this is not a bad idea. Просто люди неправильно потрактували. І от мені прийшла моя доня додому і сказала: мамо, той момент істини, про який ти нам говорила, у мене сьогодні настав. Вона мала встати і в одну хвилину сказати за всіх і за все. І це для чого ми вчимо дітей про Голодомор. І всі, кожен з нас окремо, ми можемо сприяти тому, щоб ці знання поширювалися, і таких випадків, коли людина не знає чи не хоче знати, ставало все менше, щоб люди усвідомили, якщо це ми зараз не переосмислимо, воно буде повторюватися знову і знову, десь в якихось інших куточках світу. І для початку, наприклад, можна взяти і подарувати книжку не навіть в шкільну бібліотеку, а конкретному вчителеві історії, конкретному вчителеві літератури в школі. Навіть не говоримо вже зараз за університету, починаємо зі шкіли. Тому що достатньо дорослі діти, вже починаючи від 10-річного віку, повіть тому 25-річному досвіду вчителя, вони вже сприймають. На якомусь рівні не треба їх страшити, але вже їм потрібно потрохи дозовно мати правду. І помаленьку ми вийдемо з тої ситуації, що люди не знають, відмовляються знати, а українці будуть впевнені, що слово Голодомор вже буде для всіх людей в світі звучати як символ знищення і геноциду. Дуже вам дякую ще раз за фільми, тому що я особисто ними дуже добре на практиці користаю і сподіваюся ще на більше таких чудових презентацій. Дякую.
I was taking some of the time in my forum called the Mall of Philadelphia. И чому тепер є каждовий час говорити про Голодомор, що діється тепер в Донбасі? Це те, що сталося в 33-го року, як всі 7 мільйонів українців померли. І Росія прийшла і всунула всіх росіян там до Донбасу. І це вся війна, яка тепер діється тепер в Україні, то все справді почалося від Голодомору. То тепер то росіяни хочуть забрати їхню територію. І через те, що тепер в Америці, що там сталося з Трампом і Зеленським, то також ми маємо тепер нагоду більше говорити про Голодомор і що там діється в Україні. І всі хочуть знати ці інформації, то якраз це добрий час про все це говорити про школу.
Дякую. Підтримуйте, якщо ми працюємо з молодими, хочемо їм показати, які ми деякі, ми можемо їх знайти, що ми могли не використовувати. Чи вони є на інтернеті, чи вони є на якомусь веб-сайті, чи...
Well, ми ще маємо продовжуємо ті проєкти через Україну, через Ліги. So we do have the sites, we do have content, we have the books, we have the next edition coming out. Best to bring that up to us.
Канцелярія Ліги Української Канади, ми вам передамо копію.
І мій фільм є тепер на Vimeo. То можна то знайти на інтернеті, When We Star, Vimeo, Мія Ім'я чи Кармен Еммі, чи мій продюсер також, і так можна знайти на інтернеті. І можна показувати на комп'ютері.
How can we tie in Holodomor without making mashings and some bad? Because they say, well, what's wrong with us calling on a team like the Soviet Union? We have to show them that what we're demonstrating in New York and saying, oh, 2% of the rich, you know, own everything. But how can we show them that, you know what, the road that you're taking to revolution and destroying everything that's been built up, this is what we're going to do. How can we connect the Holodomor, what was in the past, to the future of those that want to destroy everything because they have such anger at the economy, they have anger at the older generation. And I hear it all the time when I'm trying to go vote and he comes up a little more from each other's life. Oh, so what if people die in Bangladesh or die in Africa? Now that's the past. But how can we show them that, you know what, this isn't just a little more, this is like a warning signal. This is what can happen to you. So think twice before you start destroying things that you know nothing about. This is really going to extremes, but we have to tie up a little more on what's happened to make today's young people think twice before they attack others.
The way we're approaching it in the States now is we're actually trying to go into the universities and we're actually reaching out to other communities.
But they're all
less quick. My movie's actually being shown in the Holocaust Museum in Florida. And I think the people will be able to teach more about it at university levels if more groups are involved.
Товариство, вітаю. Дякую, що ви сьогодні до нас запустили. Трошки про наш проєкт про Голодомор в Ліги українців в Канаді. Цей проєкт вже триває понад 40 років. Я ще пам'ятаю, як я був молодий, то на кінець 70-х, на початок 80-х років були виставки про цей проєкт. Ті, що пам'ятають Caravan, як був павільйон Вілл,
і інші,
але в нашій домівці тоді була виставка про цей Голодомор. Були такі закони, як був Caravan, що не можна було нічого робити про політику. То навіть то, що цей павільйон був, на мою думку, один з найкращих, ми ніколи не могли виграти ту нагороду або Best Pavilion, бо подумали, щоб люди знали про цей проєкт і мусили щось про то говорити. То ми вигравали таке, like Best Show або щось таке. Орестон скоріше говорив про цей Голодомор in a box. Це почалося, я думаю, здійснилося так майже 11 років тому. Як президент Ющенко став президентом, він відчинив архіви про Голодомор. Та оригінальна книжечка «Той Голодомор in a box» має 160 сторінок. Від самого початку над цим проєктом працюють доктор Романишин і Орест Стецію. Тепер робимо такий апдейт, і ця книжечка підійде до 300 сторінок. І ще є дуже багато інформації, але тільки нема кому це зробити. На кінець я би хотів подякувати докторові Буньякові і Стевкові, що ви дали нам нагоду показати ваш фільм. Бажаю всім гарного вечора, але Лада вам хоче щось ще далі переказати.
Романе, було питання.
питання, як можна отримати ці матеріали. Перш за все, відеолінк на Vimeo буде на сторінці BCU Foundation і також через соцмережі на нашій сторінці на Facebook. Можна придбати цю книжку ззаду за $40 і також можна придбати Blu-ray DVD фільму доктора Буняка «When We Start» за $10. І також я би хотіла вам всім ще раз подякувати, так як пан Роман казав, що ви прийшли на сьогоднішню подію, а особливо нашим продюсерам і доповідачам. І я би хотіла підкреслити, що це є наша спільна історія. Дякую всім, що підтримали цей захід вашими добровільними датками, бо ви уможливлюєте подальшу нашу роботу і організувати подальші такі заходи. Дякую вам. А тільки трошки організаційних питань, я би хотіла вас усіх запросити на музично-поетичний вечір із Василем Попадюком та гостем з України Сергієм Жаданом завтра о 7:30 вечора в Інституті Святого Володимира в Торонті. Ми це спільно організуємо і підтримуємо із посольством України тут у Канаді, University of Toronto Department of Slavic Languages and Literature, та також, очевидно, із Інститутом Святого Володимира, і це все спонсорує Фундація «Будучність». А також всі отримали оцю летючку, я всіх вас запрошую, щоб ви всі прийшли 8 грудня на доктора Квіта, де він буде обговорювати оборонні національних інтересів України. Це є неділя, 8 грудня, о 2 годині, тут у Опна. Дякую вам усім.